the restless waves in the life,
in the life,
in the life,
in the life.
There are souls to rescue, there are souls to save. Send the light,
send the light,
send the light,
send the light,
the blessed gospel light,
let it shine
from shore to shore. Send the light,
the blessed gospel light,
let it shine forevermore. We have heard the Macedonian call today. Send the light,
send the light,
and the golden offering at the cross we lay.
Send the light,
send the light,
send the light,
the blessed gospel light,
let it shine
from shore to shore.
Send the light,
the blessed gospel light,
let it shine
forevermore. Let us pray that grace may everywhere abound.
Send the light,
send the light,
send the light,
and a Christ-like spirit everywhere be found.
Send the light,
send the light,
send the light,
send the light, send the light,
the blessed gospel light,
let it shine
from shore to shore.
Send the light,
the blessed gospel light,
let it shine
forevermore.
Let us not grow weary in the work of love.
Send the light,
send the light,
send the light.
Let us gather jewels for the crown above.
Send the light,
send the light,
send the light.
Gospel light,
let it shine
from shore to shore.
Send the light,
the blessed gospel light,
let it shine
forevermore.
Man, you are singing great tonight. Amen.
I think that was pretty good. Last night was better
than us. We got that much into him, right?
Hey, he'll tell you. Well, that youth group last night did better, I think, didn't it?
Oh, yeah,
you think so? Do we need to do the course again?
I believe so.
Let's do it one more time just to show them that we can, right?
Okay.
We can do this.
Miss Harmony, let's do it.
Let me go over there. Get y'all married.
Y'all
come on over here.
Give me a minute.
All right, y'all get on over.
Here we go.
Hey, guys.
Help my ears.
Oh, we're group on
the yes, in all the words.
We're a group over here.
No.
Let's just do the fourth verse again. How about the fourth verse?
All right. Hey, Scotty, you abandoned me, son.
Here we go. Well, Joe, you can get up and go over with me.
Send the light.
Send the light.
Send the light.
Send the light.
Let us gather jewels at the crown above.
Send the light.
Send the light.
Send the light.
Here we go.
Send the light,
the blessed gospel light.
Let it shine
from shore to shore.
Send the light,
the blessed gospel light.
Let it shine
forevermore.
How about a round of applause for our great
guys?
Awesome.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you, too. I think everybody should have another round of dum-dums.
Yeah.
Or another round of dum-dums should have a round of dum-dums. I don't know. What
are you doing? Dum-dum.
How about page 469 tonight? 469. We praise thee, O God. Amen.
Amen.
We praise thee, O God, for the Son of thy love. For Jesus who died and is now gone above. Hallelujah and the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah and the glory. Revive us again. We praise thee, O God, for the Spirit of light who has shown us our Savior and scattered. Hallelujah, thank the glory. Hallelujah. who hath torn all our sins and hath cleansed every stain. Hallelujah, thy glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thy glory. Revive us again. Revive us again. Fill each heart with thy love. May each soul be rekindled with fire from above. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Hallelujah, amen. Hallelujah, thine the glory. Revive us again.
Amen.
Amen.
Are you feeling kind of revived? How was the food tonight, by the way?
The cake was delicious.
You made it through it again, Dale.
You ate tonight greater than, we didn't get a count, so we
want to
know about how many
people
ate.
200.
Is there anybody that didn't eat?
Yeah. It'd be easier to say, yeah, who didn't eat? I
didn't
eat.
But I got a plate to go.
John, did you eat tonight?
Was it
good? Wasn't it good?
I didn't eat.
You didn't eat? Y'all didn't eat? What, you're anti-eaters or what?
Me.
Hey, y'all grab a Bible and stand up and turn to page 426.
A Bible?
A Bible, yeah. 426. But it's a hymn book, too. But a Bible with the other.
I heard an old, old story. Thank you, sir. And said he came from glory. Now he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I've heard about his throning, of his precious blood atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior.
Amen. You may be seated.
Amen.
would, find page 14 tonight.
14.
14.
Not 12 games.
Not the shotgun. 14, but just 14.
It is well with the
14. Who's the squirrel?
All right.
When peace like a river attendeth my brain, when sorrow like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, thou hast taught me to say, it is well.
Substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. And I hope you remember this old song. We're going to sing it a cappella tonight, which is like ice cream. It's like a la mode. No, it's a cappella, meaning no music. I'm sorry. Joe, I had him nervous there for a moment. He's like, what? No ice cream. So.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. Oh, I want to see. see you high and lifted up, shining through the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, 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 I want to see you. Oh, I want to see you.
One more time.
Open the eyes of my heart.
Well, listen to those words.
Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. Oh, I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you, to see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, 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 holy. I want to see.
Father God, we come to you tonight. We thank you for the last few nights of worship, God. And I know there's been hearts touched in this room tonight. I know there has. I know there's been hearts touched outside of this room that were impacted by the service this week, God. And the biggest thing I pray, God, is that as we pray before the service, God, that you would open hearts. Obviously, God, we can preach, we can teach, we can sing, but unless the receiver opens their hearts tonight to the word of God, it just falls on the ground, Father God. So I thank you for this opportunity to worship, to share, to shout, to praise your name. And Father God, for all the times we come together on Wednesday night and we list out all the things that we need, God, from health to financial to physical to spiritual to mental. God, tonight we just want to raise our hands and say thank you, Father God. Thank you for what you allow us. Thank you for what you've given us. And thank you for the promise of eternity in life. God, I anoint my young friend as he comes to preach to us tonight, God, that you would empower him with the Holy Spirit and we would be receptive to his words, God, and that we would realize this world is not our home, Father God. We are simply just passing through, time ticking away until we can go home. Father God, if there be one here tonight, just one, God, that doesn't know you, I pray that the Holy Spirit will impel them, God, that will draw them to you and you'll call them to salvation tonight, God, and not let them leave this room not knowing the love of Christ in your heart. Thank you for all that you allow us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Now, y'all be nice to my young friend now. He just recently graduated from college.
I seen that tag. I thought it said elder on there, but I got wrong.
That would be both of us combining our powers at one. Unite.
He's 1 Timothy, I'm 2 Timothy. Good evening and greetings from Mount Pleasant, Texas. Y'all know where that's at?
Yep.
Just over yonder. My name is Tim Williams, and I have the privilege and the gift of being able to serve as the pastor at the Vine Church in Mount Pleasant, Texas, as well as the Baptist Student Ministry Director. Before I get into my message, I do want to say thank you to you. For two reasons. One, you support my ministry. I'm gonna move this microphone down just a hair because I feel like I'm hot. I'm real hot. My voice.
Welcome to Lake of Pines Baptist Church.
I heard something. Tomorrow is my fourth wedding anniversary. 4 year wedding anniversary. So I'll get to that point here in a second. Hey. And I'll tell you, the honeymoon's still going. All right.
All right.
All right. Let's go. But anyway, so I want to say thank you to Lake of the Pines Baptist Church because two reasons. One, through your cooperative efforts at the Harmony Pittsburgh Baptist Association, we have the ability to minister to and reach the college students at Northeast Texas Community College to equip them with the gospel, to engage them with the gospel, and to encourage them to transform the world. The graduation was just a couple of weeks ago, and we're sending students all over our state and nation to move on to the next phase of their life. And so we know that the Lord has allowed us to reach them during their time with us, and we're thankful for that. I do covet your prayer as we take 8 students on a mission trip next Tuesday through Thursday. We head to Buda, Texas. So, but again, thank you for your cooperative efforts at the Harmony-Pittsburgh Baptist Association, but also through your, you may not even know this, but when you sacrificially and generously give to Lake of the Pines Baptist Church, you as a church give to the cooperative program through the Southern Baptist Convention, and I am a recipient of the Annie Armstrong Easter offering as well as cooperative program dollars. In fact, the North American Mission Board was so generous through your giving. On our way, we picked up a check for our anniversary. So thank you so much for giving to the North American Mission Board and supporting church planters and replanters like me so we can reach people who are lost and who are far from God. And so that is my heart and my passion. I like to say that there's 3 things that you need to know about me. I love Jesus. I love to talk. And I love to talk about Jesus. And so that's what I'm here to do tonight. All right?
Amen.
But that is my wife, lovely bride of almost 4 years, Heather, and our son, Easton, who is 3. And today was their last day of preschool, and I got to go to their little end-of-the-year program today. It was super sweet and super fun. So very thankful for them, and I'm thankful that they're here with us tonight. You know, this is my first revival. I've been one time to one revival when John Tanner preached a while ago. It was Heather and I's date night. That's it. Why is that the case? Because I did not become a Christian until I was 25 years old. And I didn't grow up in the church. I grew up in Colorado. I didn't know what a revival was. And so consider yourself blessed. This may be your one, you know, well, I hope. Maybe some of y'all 100th revival. I don't know, Brother Tim. He's much older than me. So, you said it. But I hope and pray, my prayer for you this week is that the theme, that your heart would be restored. And so my message tonight is going to be very practical. I'm a practical kind of guy. I'm a simple guy. I want to open the Bible and say, God, what do you want me to do? Right? Anybody else ever feel that way? Sometimes it's not that simple, and I'm not lying that every time you open the Bible, you're just going to get this is what it is. But sometimes you just need that, and that's what I've needed this week. So I believe that the Lord has prepared a message for you, for each and every one of you on this family night. Now, it's not lost on me that we attend revivals to hear great music, right? Mm-hmm. We've had some great music this week. I've watched y'all's services throughout the week. It's not lost on me that you attend a revival to hear great teaching and preaching. And it's not lost on me that you want to walk away with great stories about what God has done over the course of a few days. A lot of work, a lot of effort is put into this. And we want to be able to measure that, right? We want to be able to say, this is what God did. And none of that is bad. And I'm not here to tell anybody that it is bad. But I have this great concern in our culture that we can't actually handle a God-given revival. I'm not sure if we can actually handle it. I'm not sure if we're ready for it. Here's why. Because revival is not sitting in a room saying amen, and I covet your amens tonight. I love it, okay? But listen, it's not amening great preaching for a few nights a year and then fizzling out, because you've been challenged greatly this week. I've heard some great preaching. You've been challenged greatly, and though I was just listening on YouTube, I too was challenged. John and Zach preached the stars down, and yes, you've been greatly challenged. But revival isn't just sitting in a room hearing and amening great preaching. Revival isn't a feeling that you get, which I like to refer to as the Holy Ghost goosebumps, right?
Amen.
Listen, I know that God is in this place, and I know that He has made us in His image. Therefore, He has given us emotions to be able to express how we're feeling. But revival isn't a feeling that you get. Revival isn't an event that we attend. And may I go as far as to say, is church is not an event that you attend. Though it's been a great week this far, revival is none of that. I looked up the definition, And I just got on my young preacher at my church. He preached his second sermon, and he kept saying, I looked up that word. And I said, congratulations, I'm really glad you looked up that word. And then I just said it. I looked up this word. But here we go. Revival is an improvement in the condition or strength of something. Think about that for a second. That's what revival by definition is. So the evidence of revival is not what happens here in this place tonight. It's actually what happens tomorrow.
That's right.
And the next day, and the next day, and the next day, and until you're as old as Brother Tim.
Forever, you're saying.
And then forevermore. You know, and if you're a note taker, raise your hand if you're a note taker. I want to be able to, all right, here you go. I'm going to try to give you some notes tonight. It's my first message I've ever preached with no points. Y'all ready for this? You know that you have been revived when you walk away a changed person.
Amen.
When you walk away from this week and you run across somebody that you hadn't seen in a few weeks, a few months, they say, something's different about you. You know that you have been revived when you walk away a changed person. And listen, John Tanner is one of my greatest friends. Him and I talk every week. We've talked every week since November 2021, when he invited me for the first time to come preach at the church that he was the interim pastor. And he's been a great friend to me, a disciple maker to me, and we talk about everything, and we talk a lot about the Bible. So it's going to sound a lot like I'm repeating what he said, but in reality, listen, last night he stole a little bit of my thunder, all right? It was mine. I said, he hinted at something last night, and I'm going to take some precious moments tonight to really dive into these things that he hinted at. And that's two things. Revival starts with repentance, and it starts in the home. It's family night. So I think it's fitting that not only you as grandparents, maybe great-grandparents, parents, and you kids need to hear this message tonight. So go ahead and turn in your Bibles to Paul's letter to Titus. Paul's letter to Titus, and you think, what in the world is he going to do with this? I'm going to pray, and then I'm going to give you some more time to turn to Titus, and then we will dive into the scriptures tonight. Who wants to get into the Bible? Yeah? I guess nobody. All right. Let's pray. Father, as we approach you humbly, we know that you are God, that you are high and lifted up. God, may we come to this place with a open heart. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be a model for those around us, for those who are in our midst, and those who will be a changed person even after this. God, may you receive the glory for that. And I pray, God, that your word would speak, that it would be what your word says it is. It's authoritative and sharper than a two-edged sword. It's true. And we confess right now that Jesus Christ is Lord, and that we believe in our hearts that he raised from the dead to give us forgiveness of sin and for the hope of eternal life. Speak to us now, Lord, would you? We are willing. Here we are to listen. We love you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Now, I like to, in my church, I like to tell our people to, when you get to the place of the Bible that I've asked you to turn to, then you just say simply, I love my Bible. And you can say that anytime, because I love to hear, I love my Bible. So if you've gotten to Titus, I love my Bible. And don't worry, if you're looking at the table of contents, it's okay. Shout it out when you get there. It's fine, all right? I have a question. How many of you have great concern over the future of our nation because of the lack of young Christians? Be honest.
Christian, period.
Okay. We have a great concern over the future of the church because of a lack of Christian morality in our culture, right?
For sure.
You don't have to be, reclusive to figure out that our nation, yes, is definitely different than it was 30 years ago when I was born, right?
Yeah. Yes.
And if you read the statistics, it's frightening. It's incredibly frightening. And all the stats that you see, how young people are leaving the churches in groves, and all of these things, they're frightening. And in my context, I minister to a lot of young people. It's just how we are. When I got to our church, the average age was, you know, like 78. Now the average age is like 32. It's just the people that God has allowed us to minister to. And I spend a lot of time on the college campus and and around college students. And over the last 3 years, there's been this common theme among young people where they're coming at this at the question about their relationship with Christ with two common themes, two kind of responses that I can see a trend in our context here in Northeast Texas. Here's what they are. First, they relate their relationship with Christ to the church. So meaning, hey, tell me about your relationship with Christ. Well, I grew up in church. Okay, cool. Tell me about your relationship with Jesus. Like, tell me about your personal, intimate relationship with a holy God. Tell me about that. Well, I grew up at that church. Okay, so that's one. Two, they're desperately trying to figure out their purpose in life. Desperately. And they're going to the end of everything to find what purpose they have in life. And so, please, if you're under 45 tonight, let me tell you that you have a great purpose in life. That is to glorify God by enjoying His creation. If you're older than 45 tonight, let me tell you, you have a great purpose in life, and that's to enjoy God by worship God by enjoying His creation. There we go. I'll get my words straight. It's halfway through the week. We're all right. I'm thinking about my anniversary tomorrow, and you know,
he ain't got that gift yet.
But I'm not convinced that these two questions is just a young people question. I'm not convinced that these two situations are just for young people. It's not just a young people problem. It's not just a problem with this generation. Because I talked to my grandparents, and my grandparents say the same thing about their parents' generation. They say, my parents didn't like my generation when I was in my 20s either. We did things different. We did things opposite of the way that they wanted us to do them. We thought differently. The world was changing. They weren't willing to change. We were, and there was just this opposition. And it's just a normal thing that happens. Every generation has it, okay? And so it's not a young people problem. We don't have a young people problem. Instead, we have a discipleship problem. The reason why we are worried about, you know, the lack of young believers in our lives is because we have a discipleship problem. This evening, my prayer is that we would all be reminded of God's purpose and plan for our life, and that the word that is sharper than a two-edged sword and cuts to bone and marrow will grip our hearts and change us from the inside, because we don't have a young people problem. We have a discipleship problem. I'm going to jump around Titus for a moment here. Look with me first, and I'm going to give you the theme of this entire book, this book that's written by the Apostle Paul to his young friend Titus in Crete. He says, Paul, a servant of God, the apostle of Jesus Christ, for the sake of the faith of God's elect and their knowledge of the truth, which accords with godliness. That's the point of his message. Everything about this letter goes back to verse 1. For the sake of the faith of God's elect and their knowledge of the truth which accords with godliness. What's he talking about? Knowledge of the truth which accords with godliness. So the knowledge of the things that are true which produces godliness. He says this in the beginning, and he actually clarifies what he's talking about in verse 11. So skip with me to verse 11. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passions and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession, who are zealous for good works. So Paul writes this letter to talk about this very thing. He's saying, I want you to be raised up in godliness. I want you to have a change in your life. I want your heart to be made from a heart of stone to a heart of flesh, to be changed from the inside out. And this is what it's going to look like. This is how it's going to be fleshed out. It will show, because, and this is why, because the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation to all people. Jesus Christ came as a human being, born of immaculate conception to a virgin mother, lived a perfect and sinless life to die the death on the cross that we deserve. Because this happened, your faith in that message, in the message of the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, will produce, your faith in the knowledge of this will produce godliness. And that's what he's calling every one of us to. We don't have a young people problem, we have a discipleship problem. If you have been a believer, listen, if you have been a believer for any moment in time, I don't care if you became a believer 30 seconds ago when I just shared the gospel and said, you have the opportunity to believe in this. If that's when you place your faith in Jesus Christ, you now have the God-given command to disciple somebody else. It's not an option. You have the command. And you say, well, how can I have the command? I don't know anything. I'm a wretch. I'm a broken sinner. And I just know that Jesus died for me. That's all I know. Congratulations. You know a whole lot more than that lost person sitting next to you. Because here's the reality. There's always going to be somebody behind you. And so Paul knows this. Paul knows that there's always going to be somebody spiritually a half a step behind you. Dr. Matt Queen says that if you know enough of the gospel to be saved by the gospel, then you know enough of the gospel to share the gospel. All right? So this is where I'm at. All right? So here, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to talk to two sets of people. Because there's only two different genders in this country, right? Or in this world, in human beings, right? There's males and there's females. So I'm going to first talk to the males, and then we're going to talk to the ladies. And we'll kind of mix it in a little bit. Okay? It's not ladies first tonight because, men, I got a little bit longer of a message for you. Revival starts with repentance. And it starts in the home. And that's exactly what Paul tells Titus. A restored heart starts in the home. Now, you may think, does anybody in chapter 1, look right above verse 5. In your Bible, does it have like a little subheader? Maybe it says qualifications for elders or something like that. Understand that that's not inspired by the Holy Spirit. That's an interpreter's action, right? He's just trying to clarify for us, make it a little bit easier for us as we read our Bibles. But that's not Holy Spirit inspired. And this specific subheader, I just don't find incredibly accurate. Here's why. Let's read it, and then you'll see here in a second. Verse 5, this is why I left you in Crete, so that you might put what remained into order, and appoint elders in every town as I directed you. If anyone is above, okay, let me just stop. So he says here, so that you might put what remained in order and appoint elders in every town as I directed you. And so this is, according to the translators, they're saying this is the qualifications for elders. And it is. It is. Absolutely. This is where you go when you want to hear about what qualifies you to be a pastor, elder, bishop, overseer. They're all interchangeable terms. But may I remind you that as a man, you are the overseer and the pastor of your home.
That's right. Amen.
And this is not just a call to make Brother Tim or me or any other God-called pastor of a church to be a higher and holier man than the rest of you men. In fact, Jesus died for you so that you would grow in godliness, be sanctified in godliness to grow to the same level of maturity, to be complete, lacking in nothing. And so, reason number one why I believe that this specific passage here, verses specifically 5 through 9, is not talking about just pastors. It's talking about every man. First, look with me in verse 6. This is all Paul tells Titus to tell the younger men. Urge the younger men to be self-controlled. Period. Urge the younger men to be self-controlled. But wait a second here. Let's look at what he told the ladies. He told the ladies to teach what is good, and so train the young women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled, pure, working at home, kind, and submissive to their own husbands, that the word of God may not be reviled. I mean, are men that much greater that they just don't need a whole long list of things that they have to do? No, it's because he's already told the men what to be like. He's already described what a godly man looks like. And so he just says, hey, make sure you tell the younger men to be self-controlled on top of all these things. Reason number 2, verse 7. He goes back to talking to all the people and he says, show yourself in all respects to be a model of good works. If I'm going to model something, if I'm going to say, hey, this is how you change your oil in your car, it's because, not because I just want to show you how, you know, out of my breath, like, I, you know, just the kindness of my heart. It's because I want to show you how so then you can do it yourself next time, right? Y'all track it with me here. You model something for somebody because that's what you want them to actually do. not because you're just doing it out of the kindness of your heart. And you might be kindly, you know, out of your heart, you know, teaching them how to do it, but you get what I'm saying. So that's two reasons. And the first reason might have been a little bit of a stretch there. I understand that in verse 6. But verse 7 is pretty sure. And here, let me give you a surefire reason why I believe 5 through 9 is the call for every one of you with the gender M male. I read this list, and as a parent, there's not one thing on here that I don't want my son to be like.
That's right.
And if I was a parent of a young lady, there's nothing on this list that I wouldn't want her future husband to be like. So if that's the case, when Paul says to Titus, hey, older women, or older men, be sober-minded, dignified, self-control, sound in faith, in love, and in steadfastness, likewise, urge the younger men. And keeping in mind, Jesus had already told them to go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations. So that they get to this point of understanding that, okay, what does this actually look like? What is revival? Okay, how do we actually get a change of heart? Because I can teach you all day long how to pray. We can teach you how to read your Bible. We can teach you how to sing and how to have a daily quiet time. And, you know, we could even teach you how to be a giving person. We can urge you to do those things. But it's not until you have a desire in your heart regenerated by the Holy Spirit of God that you will actually do them. And that's what he's saying. He's saying, listen, I want you, for the sake of the faith of God's elect, the God's people, for the faith, faith is, you know, hoping in the things unseen, like Brother Tim just said, because of the knowledge of the truth, because you know the gospel. You know the extent that Jesus went to forgive you of your sin. Because you know these things, then there's an action behind this that produces something out of you. The repentance that you act in produces something, and that's what's called godliness. Paul writes to the Ephesians, he says it's true righteousness and holiness. It's the likeness of Christ, which is true righteousness and holiness. And so, if we want revival starts with repentance. It's turning back from our flesh and turning to God. And it starts in the home, where men are above reproach. They're not easily questioned. You know that when he shakes your hand and looks you in the eye, he's serious. He ain't going to lie to you. You know that when nobody else is looking, he is a man of integrity. You know that he's a husband of one wife. And listen, we can get into all the fights that you want to about this, but here's what I'm telling you. He ain't a player. That's what it is. He ain't a player. He doesn't have multiple wives. Okay, polygamy wasn't really an issue in this time in Crete. They were a lot of things according to their government, but polygamy wasn't a thing. He's just saying he wasn't a player. And then he says his children are believers. Okay, let me relieve some pressure off your shoulders for a second. It's not really a good translation. There's not really a good word in the English to figure out the Greek here. But what I do know is it's not that they are believers. Here's why. My son's 3 years old. He doesn't have the ability to be a believer right now. He doesn't have the comprehension of sin and Holy Spirit and these things. So does that disqualify me from pastoral ministry?
No.
No. It's saying that your children are faithful. They're faithful. They're not open to the charge of debauchery. You're not just letting your kids run amok. Meaning, you're the parent of your kids. Your parents ain't, or your kids ain't parenting you.
Amen.
Okay? Like, you're parenting your kids. You ain't their friend. You're the parent. That's what he's saying. He said, listen, men, you need to be your kid's dad. You need to be your kid's dad. For an overseer, the pastor of the home, as God's steward, must be above reproach. He cannot be arrogant. He can't be quick-tempered. Now, here's the thing. I'm going to zoom through these because I think I can probably beat a little bit of a dead horse here. All right? It's really easy for us to come to church on Sunday morning and put on a face.
That's right.
But here's why I say revival starts in the home. There's nobody who knows your holiness as much as your wife does. Right? You could be on the way. Listen, I've been there. Been on the way to church, griping, bickering, fighting. And you get to church. And, hey, brother, how are you doing? You doing good, right? Like nothing ever happened, right? And meanwhile, your wife's like, man, he was just bickering at me. He was just short-tempered. He was
on the way home.
Yeah, okay, we're on the way home, you know. And that's what I'm saying. Revival starts with repentance, and it starts at home. Because when you start to display godliness in the home, guess what? It will bleed over into the church. It will bleed over into the community. You want the community around you to become noticeably better. Grow in your godliness. Be discipled. Okay. So I'm just going to zoom through these, and I'll come back to them at the end of this message, okay? I've never preached a message like this where it's all over the place, but I think we're tracking somewhere. So we get to this place where he's giving these, you know, just characteristic traits. He starts with the characteristics within the family, his character around other people, and his character within himself. And then he gets to this verse 9. He must hold firm to the trustworthy word as taught. And so you say, surely this ain't about me, because I'm not a pastor. That's what you men are saying right now. I can hear it. It's all right. I hear it. But yet, the Bible also says to raise up our children as they should go in the word. And so we can't be relying on the men at church to be teaching our kids the Bible. That's your responsibility in the home.
Amen.
God gave you the Holy Spirit of God to live inside of you, to be the priest of your family, to be the pastor of your family. And if we want revival in our churches, it's got to start in the home. Now, ladies, let me just address this for a second, because you're like, okay, is he going to dive into this working at home thing? Because I got a job, so what's this actually say? So look with me, chapter 2, verse 3. Older women, likewise, are to be reverent in behavior, not slanderers or slaves to much wine. They are to teach what is good, and so train the young women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled, pure, working at home, kind and submissive to their own husbands, that the word of God may not be reviled. So ladies, how do you have revival that starts at home? Well, here's how. You live this out. Now, working at home, let's address it real quick. It's not saying that you can't have a job, right? It's just that you're the homekeeper, right? Your husband needs to help you with the dishes. This isn't a free pass, men, all right? Like, in fact, if your wife normally does the dishes, you probably should go home and do the dishes. I'm just saying, all right? Like, if your wife is normally the one switching the laundry, it's okay if you go home and switch the laundry. She'll probably really love you. You might get a kiss on the cheek later. I don't know, okay? But at the end of the day, the whole purpose of this is that we don't have a young people problem. We have a discipleship problem. We are teaching women and young women how to be really good church members. We teach them that they should have perfect attendance, and that, you know, I love Awana. Like, it's great program, but is it about the ribbon if it doesn't ever make it to the heart? You know what I'm saying? Like, I love kids ministry, but is it about the crafts if it never makes it to the heart? And it's never going to make it to the heart if we're not teaching it in the home, and we're never going to be able to teach it in the home if we're not modeling it in the home. And so now, you might be, hey, I don't have kids in the house. So now what? God hasn't blessed me with kids. So now what? Or my kids are grown. They're gone.
Yes.
So now what? You got neighbors? You got fatherless boys and girls in your neighborhood? I know there is. I know that this area of Northeast Texas, I was just sitting down with a guy a few months ago talking about the fatherlessness in our area, and it's great. It's frightening. It's sad. You can be the God-given parent for a child that changes their life, that absolutely changes their life by you displaying godliness. And you're thinking, man, not me. Who am I to do any of these things, right? Like, I'm so far gone. Do you know who I am? Well, guess what? Paul also said those things. In fact, in Romans chapter 8, Romans chapter 7, he says, I do the things that I don't want to do, and I don't do the things that I do want to do. So what in the world is this? What a wretched man I am. And he says, but yet still, Christ died for me, so therefore there is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. What did I say just a few minutes ago? If you got saved 30 seconds ago, you got the opportunity and the command to disciple somebody else. There's nobody too far gone, too bad, too wretched. Because if that was the case, then I shouldn't be standing here. You understand what I'm saying? And so we have this, we get to this place of saying, okay, heard a really, really, really great message about Jacob. New heart, last night, the God of the house. Heard about, you know, the really, really giving ourselves to the church, respecting our pastor. And tomorrow's coming, so now what? Well, now you have this opportunity to say, oh man, God's calling me to a high calling. He died and paid a big price for me, and all he's asking for me is to grow in godliness, and he tells me how. It's very practical here in the book of Titus, this letter of Paul to Titus. And so, how do you know that you've been revived? You know that you've been revived if you walk away a changed person. When you could walk away and say, okay, God, I'm going to surrender these things to you right now. I hadn't been self-controlled. I have been quick-tempered. I'm not sober-minded all the time. I'm not a husband of one wife because I've got eyes for some other woman. And you have the opportunity. You have the opportunity to turn back, to say, God, your way is better. And I surrender to you right now. That change only happens by faith and your knowledge of the truth, which accords with godliness and hope of eternal life, which God, who never lies, promised before the ages began and at the proper time manifested in his word through the preaching with which I have been entrusted by the command of God, our Savior. The grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness. And here's a quote I read this week, and it cut me to the core. If there's anything this culture celebrates, it's someone living in rebellion to God's biblical design.
Ain't that the truth?
But if there's anything this culture hates, it's someone insisting we live according to God's biblical design.
Right, right. Amen. That's right.
The design of the family. Because, listen, isn't it great that God's design is actually perfect? He made it. I'm studying a lot in the Minor Prophets right now as I preach through a sermon series, and my wife is teaching her ladies through the book of Revelation. And we're constantly reminded of God's judgment and the judgment that is to come. And of course, we see the culture around us, and we can gripe about it all we want, and we can say, this world is going to hell in a handbasket, all we want. But what are we doing to actually change it? So we don't have a young people problem, we have a discipleship problem. God gave us the command to go and make disciples. And he gives us tools to say, here's how you model being a disciple maker. And I got a whole nother message that I could preach to you about how you'd be a disciple maker. But I don't know, it's Wednesday night, 8 o'clock. We might want to get home. But the grace of God appeared to train us to renounce worldly passions, to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in the present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who gave himself up for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. That's God's purpose for you. What an amazing grace for him to offer that for you, to wash you white as snow, to purify for himself, to the praise of his glorious grace, as it says in Ephesians, for his own possession, who are zealous, who are excited, who are antsy, who are chomping at the bit to go and display the love of Jesus Christ to the people around him, because we know that the world sent Jesus Christ, our Lord, because of our love and by how we treat other people. So I'm not going to ask you tonight if you've been revived. In fact, you don't need to ask yourself or anybody else tonight. You'll know tomorrow. You don't have to ask anybody. You'll know. We'll know if God is doing a work in your heart, if you are finally surrendering to him. We will know if you're repentant, if tomorrow you're a changed person. And we can see it, we can experience it, we can hear it. And you know who's going to most know about it? It's those people in your home. Those ones where you can't wear a mask. But I do know this. God came in the likeness of man in the person of Jesus Christ, the Messiah, born of Immaculate Conception, just to give his life for you and for me so that we might believe in him and have the hope of eternal life, to be forgiven from our sin. He raised from the dead so he could defeat sin and the grave and the enemy once and for all, and we have this great promise that he is going to return. That's what Paul says, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the great, or of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, the one who is holy and mighty and magnificent, the God and the Father of all. So in order to be revived, you must first be revived. That's what John Tanner said last night. Guess what? That was my line too. In order to be revived, you must first be revived. So if you are, listen, I don't know how much more urging. You live in a phenomenal place. Not only is it beautiful here, great fishing, but there's Christians everywhere. You have the Bible readily available in your hand, so why would you not believe? If you've seen the glorious grace that manifested in the body of Christ, the local church, that's why you exist as a church, is to be the manifold wisdom of God displayed to the world around you. If you've seen these things with your eyes, if you've seen changed people before you, then why would you not trust in the same God? The only God. The only way. I do think, you know, there's that one line in that old time religion song that says it's the way to heaven. There's only one way.
Right.
He is the way, the truth, and the life, and his name is Jesus Christ.
Right.
Religion, sitting in these chairs, ain't going to get you to heaven.
Nope.
Coming to this revival, getting the Holy Ghost goosebumps, guess what? Those could be from the devil. It ain't going to get you to heaven. Only Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, will get you to heaven, and it's by your faith in him that will cause repentance from your heart, a change in your heart, and revival will be stoked, and it will last throughout the ages. His grace is sufficient. So come to him. Give it up. I'm talking mostly to the men right now because I think that, I mean, it's easier to talk to men for me. Just give it up. Lay it at the cross. All you who are weary and heavy laden, come to me, and I will give you rest. And in order to be revived, you must be vived. You must be born again, as Jesus says in John chapter 3. And he came preaching, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So tonight, I think we got an opportunity to do some business with God. Now, a lot of you may be saying, I've been a Christian for a really long time. I've been a really long time, Brother Tim. And you're saying, what am I supposed to do? How do I be revived? Again, revival starts with repentance, and it starts at home. Changing your heart, allowing the Word of God to change your heart, to grip your heart so tight that you have no choice but to change. That you say, this Word is true. From cover to cover, from in the beginning to amen in the back, it's true. And believing that, trusting in it, and giving all of yourself to model for good works to others around you so they may too grow in godliness. And I think if you've been a Christian for a long time and you have never discipled somebody, then you have some real repentance to be doing.
Yeah.
There are people, and I'm saying younger, by the way, I should have said this in the very beginning. I'm saying young people, I'm not talking age. I'm talking about spiritually young. There's someone spiritually younger than you right now that you could be pouring your heart into. It's going to be hard. It's going to be gritty. Again, this gets into the other message about discipleship that I have. But I think you got some business to do with God and say, God, I'm so sorry. And if you don't have somebody right now, God, give me somebody tonight. Somebody come up to me and say, I want you to teach me and tell me why you got what you got. Because I can see that you're two steps ahead of me. You quoted that verse today, Vern. You know what you're talking about. I don't, and I want to know what you're talking about. You see what I'm saying? Are you ready for that? Are you ready for somebody to come up to you and say, tell me about being godly. Explain to me, did people before Jesus Christ, before the Holy Spirit came inside of them, did they go to heaven? Can you answer that question?
Yeah.
You've been a Christian for any sort of time. You might be posed with that question, because guess what? I was posed with that today. Lost boy asking a friend of mine's, and my friend of mine called me and said, I don't know how to answer this question. We need to be able to answer these questions. We need to be able to defend the truth. Because the world out there
sure ain't.
celebrates someone living in rebellion to God's biblical design and hates someone insisting that we live according to God's biblical design. So let's be a people that is committed, devoted to the apostles' teaching, to the prayers, the fellowship, to the breaking of bread, living out according to God's biblical design. Let's pray. God, sometimes the pressure that we feel in life gives us, or makes us have blinders. So God, would you open the eyes of our heart? God, could we see past our own problems to see your purpose? God, to see the people around us who are hurting, where we should be filled with the fruit of the Spirit, God, and we are distracted. We are weighed down. We are burdened by our own flesh. God, would you open the eyes of our hearts as you mold our hearts into your likeness of true righteousness and holiness, as you take out our old heart and put in a new heart, as you take off our old clothes and you wash us and you put on new clothes, God, may we surrender to you right now to understand that your biblical design is for us to be the display of your love to those around us so that others would come to know you and to grow like you. God, we know that salvation is just the beginning, that we got a life of sanctification, a life of being discipled, of growing in Christ-likeness. And God, I pray for the day that I arrive. Because it's a grind, it's hard. God, and every day I fall short of your glory. But I thank you for your Son, Jesus, who is there interceding on my behalf, who bore my sin, past, present, and future, on the cross, and who offers forgiveness and the hope of eternal life. God, we long for your return, and if you tarry, God, I pray that you would give us an opportunity to teach others by our whole life, by the display of our life as a model for others to grow in godliness. God, I pray that this message tonight would just sink into our hearts, would grip us and change us, and may we be revived again. We love you, we praise you, we believe in you, and we surrender to you. And it's in Jesus Christ our Lord's name that we pray. Amen.
Page 305.